Anticipate a riot. This common crowd is much too loud. Tell the mob who sing your songs that they are fools and they are wrong. They are a curse. They should disperse.
This is a new day. This is a new day full of sound and light and expectation. This day has been waiting for you. This day has been waiting especially for you to embrace you, to guide you. This day has been waiting with open arms just for you. This is the day we have been given. Let's not waste it. Come now and let us worship together. Welcome, everybody. We are streaming live via Zoom at 1105 Elm Street. I'm Reverend Joseph Boyd. For those tuning in from across the nation, welcome to our home here in Youngstown, Ohio. We have been ordered to stay at home until at least May 1st, so we will be offering live virtual ministry until then, at least. It's been amazing this past week. Our church activities have grown so much that I have a number of announcements for you this morning. So many of you know that our director of religious education, Mystery Wallace, went home to California for health reasons. Well, now she is sheltered in place in California and has offered to be our virtual director of religious education from her home in California. So we've started up again with religious education. Our first class will be today at 3 o'clock via Zoom. So if you have children or if you know of families that may want to have an activity for their children, it'll be about 20, 25 minutes and it will start at 3 o'clock. At 5 o'clock today, we have an adult forum discussion. John Shardle will be speaking about his experience of being a prison warden in a federal prison at 5 o'clock. So you're welcome to join in to that this evening at 5 o'clock. And throughout the week, we have activities every single day of the week so that you can stay connected to our church and to each other and to yourselves during this time. On Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, 11 a.m. to noon, we have an experienced Tibetan Buddhist practitioner, Linda Scharf, who is leading us through meditation. That's Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 11 a.m. to noon. 12:30 to 1 o'clock, Gary Davenport is offering a half-hour check-in for those just to check in with each other and have a bit of socializing during this time, during the time that we're apart. And on Friday evening, we have a special workshop. It's a storyteller's workshop. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the moth, but we're going to offer a personal storytelling workshop through Zoom with each other. And the theme is crossing the threshold. So please tune into that. You can get updated about this information through our website, which will be updated every single day. You also can find out through our Facebook, which will also be updated every single day. So if you forget any of these events, just tune in every single day to our website and our Facebook to be reminded about this information. And also this coming Saturday, please tune in. We're going to be celebrating and honoring the life of Marceline Hawk Mayhall. That's going to be this Saturday, 10:30 a.m. Please come and participate. If you have a couple words you'd like to share, there will be an opportunity for that. So please tune in for that Saturday, 10:30 a.m. And we will be streaming that via Zoom. And final announcement, I heard that today is Sue Alexander's birthday. So I would like to do something which is a bit of a stretch of our imagination. Due to our system, we're gonna have all of you stay unmuted, but we're gonna sing happy birthday and know that people from across Youngstown, across this valley, across this nation are gonna be singing happy birthday. And we'll have Tim and Jennifer come up and Jeff, and we'll sing happy birthday to Sue.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Sue. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you, everybody.
And thank you so much. Thank you.
It'll actually be next Sunday. So stay tuned for that. It won't be this evening, but next Sunday. And okay. Now we go to Anita Wessler in Seattle, Washington, who will be offering our chalice lighting.
Next Sunday.
Good morning. I'm Anita Wessler. So happy to join you from Seattle, Washington. This morning, it gives me an extra boost to see faces and hear voices that I recognize. With everything that's going on right now, it feels weird to accept a new normal and to simultaneously try to reconcile feelings we're all experiencing as the feelings change day by day, moment by moment. For me, first came shock and denial of being cut off from all activities and events in Seattle, just as it felt like I was beginning to acclimate after moving from Youngstown 18 months ago. After that initial shock, came fear as news photos showed grocery store shelves emptied by panicked shoppers. Walks in my neighborhood were distressing too. Even though self-distancing was respected, I could come home and carefully wash my hands while singing two rounds of happy birthday, but it was distressing because shops were locked and windows boarded up with plywood, some glass already shattered by disgruntled individuals, giving the neighborhood a bleak, almost apocalyptic feeling. Well, artists are now painting most of the plywood on storefronts. There are other glimmers of hope. Sunnier days and blossoms on cherry trees help. but more so the returning of smiles and greetings from neighbors as we carefully pass on sidewalks. At 8 in the evening, there's quite a racket on my street as many apartment dwellers sing, clap, and bang pots and pans to show appreciation to medical people and all those working on the front lines. We are finding a myriad of ways to reach out and connect with one another. You, like me, are probably remembering grandparents who, without the internet, lived through epidemics, a Great Depression, and two world wars. Just as their strength nurtured me, I hope to be a beacon of compassion and calm. My words and experiences are most likely the same that you are hearing all around you and within you. We are in this together. Let us live each day growing in gratitude, courage, and joy. As I light this chalice,
Jenny-centric.
As I light this chalice, may we feel peace and love and do our best to share it.
Please join me in reading.
Myers.
Hello. Please join me in reading the covenant, which can be found in the online order of service. Love is the spirit of this church, and service its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Each month, we give to an organization that supports transformation in our community, which is the heart of our mission. In the month of March, we are giving to the League of Women Voters in Greater Youngstown. There's a link to give on the front page of our website, UUYO, and you can mail a check to our church address. This info is found below in your chat box on Zoom. The Steer the Plate Committee has decided to turn our support for our community inward to our church community at UUYO during these unprecedented and challenging times, living in a world responding to the COVID-19 pandemic. As Reverend Joseph has shared, many church members and families have already been affected by dramatic changes to our daily lives. Some individuals have lost work, resulting in economic hardships like figuring out how to pay the bills, food, or medication. Others who are older adults or have underlying health concerns, though they are staying at home, have become isolated and unable to travel to make essential trips like going grocery shopping. And all of us are stressed, anxious, and worried. But it is important to remind ourselves that we are all in this together. We need each other's love and support now more than ever. Our generous Share the Plate donations for April will go to UUYO's Minister's Discretionary Fund, so that Reverend Joseph can respond directly to members of our church family who need our support. Reverend Joseph welcomes and encourages emails and phone calls to connect. The closing words we hear each Sunday ring louder and more clear now more than ever. You are loved and never truly alone. We will now receive the offering that supports the life of Youngstown, the Mahoning Valley, and our wider world.
Oh,
Please join me in a period of silent meditation.
Reading today comes from Luke 19:28-42. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked him, "Why are you untying the colt?" They said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with loud voice, for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop. He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, "If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes."
I can walk and walk. I shall will talk together about walking. Dare shall be carried, and when we both have had enough, I will take you from my shoe, singing, meet your new road.
Then the man they called Judas Iscariot went to the chief priests and said, "What will you give me to betray him to you?" They paid him 30 pieces of silver. From that moment, he began to look out for an opportunity to betray him.
Carl sat daily asking for change at the intersection of Belmont Avenue and the ramp to the 680 South. He sat there across from a gas station with a cardboard sign and sometimes a black crate he would sit on. I never personally saw another driver give him any money other than the spare change I had in the console of my van. But I was amazed at how consistently he sat at that intersection. He sat there in January and February, even on the few days we had this year that were quite frigid. I never thought of Carl as a beggar, and I don't even know if he was homeless. I never asked. I always thought of him as someone who was making his living watching us all go wherever we were going. Destinations at once predictable and forgetful. He would watch me drive by once, twice, sometimes three times a day. There was a kind of ritual to our interactions that I don't think about, that I didn't think about too much. Now I think about it. Carl is no longer waiting there at that spot. I hope he's okay, but I don't know. I have driven to that spot a couple times in the last week, and I've been the only car at that intersection. There is a kind of grief of something, for something that is hard to name. Maybe it was a sense of consistency, or even the easiness with which I exchanged money hand to hand with a stranger and thought nothing about it. All this to say, moments like this have become quite precious to me now. I've mentioned this because I've talked with a number of you who have expressed that you're feeling grief. grief. It's not always directly related to the weirdness of this time or a loss of employment. Some have mentioned to me they're feeling more acutely the loss of a loved one at this time. Some have said there's a feeling of grief for something that can't quite be named, though their lives don't seem to be adversely impacted at this moment. But I think our lives are always impacted by what we experience, even if we don't register it in the moment. I have never preached a Palm Sunday sermon, but I thought this was the year to do it. Palm Sunday is traditionally a day of jubilee, of the celebration of a king who brings a message of peace to the center of political and social power, symbolized in Jerusalem. I don't think you need to be a Christian to appreciate this, and I'll tell you why. I prefer Luke's telling of this because he brings up concerns that are the concerns of all of us, regardless of who or what we believe in. First, there are no palms in this gospel. There are cloaks, outer garments, jackets that are laid on the ground. There's a kind of stripping down, not to the point of nakedness, but just to the point that you can feel the sun on your arms. And you can tell by the feel on your skin which way the wind is blowing. With the outer layer taken off, we are more vulnerable. We are not vulnerable to the point of discomfort, but just enough that we can feel what is going on. Finally, maybe, feel what is going on in our life. And what has been going on, whether we're aware of it or not. We can feel how much shade impacts our experience and how wonderful it is to feel direct light when the clouds decide to part, all of which is not in our control. Most people who celebrate Palm Sunday are aware of how the rest of the story goes. It marks the beginning of Holy Week, less than a week before the crucifixion. Many of us are more in touch with our mortality at this moment. I think this is true of everyone, regardless of age, regardless of health circumstance. There is a sense right now of how precarious life is. There is concern for the mortality of our loved ones and those in our community. There is nothing like the concern of mortality to cut through our confusion of what really matters to us and what we hope our life to be about. We just want everyone to be okay. We want to stay healthy, and we hope to stay alive. It doesn't seem to haunt us, perhaps, as much now, what our life should be about, or what we should have done, or about ambition, in the way that maybe we've understood that word. It is good enough to be alive, and feel and appreciate that we are alive. We can appreciate small gestures, like taking off our coat and allowing ourselves to feel what is going on around us. This is the only gospel when Jesus sees Jerusalem and he weeps. Why does he weep? Maybe a better question is, why wouldn't he weep? In the moment we are in, we don't need to find good reasons to weep. But I think the weeping goes far deeper than melancholy. It is a weeping, perhaps, of what still may come. It's looking at the center of power, economically, socially, and politically, and seeing how vulnerable our body is. Our body politic is vulnerable and easily swayed. We too often seem to miss what is right in front of us. Perhaps the only thing that really mattered. Our greatest desires are so confusing. We can live lives that are so inundated with other people's thoughts and worries that they become inseparable from our own perception of what is worth thinking and worrying about. Sometimes Palm Sunday is seen as a great big party when everyone is boisterous and loud and cheering like a concert or a Super Bowl game. But I imagine it differently. When it says the multitude of disciples rejoice, many of us know Jesus had a small number of disciples. I imagine a raucous few who excitedly realize what was happening, a new way of being, a new rule of government based on peace. But in my imagining, most people in Jerusalem were too busy to notice, and they missed it. It was, as Tim Raritan mentioned to me, one of the most ingenious street protests in world history, something that we still recall today. But I bet it was missed or largely ignored in its time. It is eerie that we are in a moment when even the stones are crying out. The earth itself is calling out, begging, calling out to us to find something to rejoice about. The stones seem to be calling us as witnesses rather than the other way around. There is an awaiting of peace. Peace in the center of economic, political, and social power. A peace that is finally front and center in our lives. A peace that guides our day-to-day living. A peace that was there all along, perhaps, but has proven elusive. When we look ahead, we will weep. We will weep for the promise that may go unfulfilled. But I see it differently, or perhaps not quite as stark as this. My favorite line of the text is the one following the weeping. It says, "If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes." It's a notable phrase. If you, even you, could recognize it. If you, even you, recognized what was right in front of your face all along, the obvious of obvious on this day, things could be different. If you, even you, someone irritable and easily distracted, could see the joy of life that is entering your city at this moment. If you, yes, even you, could see that. This means we don't need to quit. We need to quit relying on our so-called leaders and experts to realize how precious life is and how precious being alive is and how wonderful it is to live according to a law of peace and play rather than force and violence. Yes, you, even you, don't wait for someone wiser to come along. Don't wait for a messiah. Don't wait for a president. Don't wait for a leader you can respect. Don't wait for the words of a health expert. Don't wait at all. If you, even you, could see this opportunity right in front of you, right here, right now, we could weep tears of joy. That is possible. That is why I like the cyclical nature of these holidays. We get another shot, folks. We get another opportunity to see the procession come our way and show us we can live, truly live, not only in grief, but in glad expectation. If you, only you, even you, could see this. I wanted to close by saying a few words about peace. Peace is not the absence of conflict. Peace is not the absence of problems. Peace is not the absence of grief. Peace is not the absence of power and triumph. Peace is not the absence of weeping. Peace is not a rare quality that needs to be managed diligently like an old engine that is always threatening to die on us. Peace is not the absence of disease. Peace is not the absence of fear. Peace is not the absence of worry, stress, and obsession. Peace loves a song outside a window. Peace loves music, but doesn't require musicality. Peace does not care how wise and intelligent you are. Peace doesn't care if you meditate or eat right, though those are good things to do. Peace doesn't care if you're in a good mood. Peace doesn't care if you're feeling generous or stingy, brave or small-minded. Peace doesn't rely on ideal conditions or on ideal people. Thank goodness. If this was the case, peace would only be a fiction, not real or strong or deep. Peace is pervasive. It's everywhere. Literally, everywhere. Yes, you, even you, have peace. Peace is the capacity to live in wholeness, to weep for a fallen civilization and live into the promise of resurrection, even though we have a truly hard time seeing it. Peace is the willingness to see what has always been there, but overlooked. Peace sees what is inconvenient, what is troubling, what is hopeful. Peace has the ears to hear the stones cry out and rejoice a coming day, a day we are asked to be part of. So like last week, I'd like to offer a couple questions to hopefully provoke some conversation during the talk back for at least 5-10 minutes. So here are the questions. The first question: what does peace mean to you? First question: what does peace mean to you? Second question: can you see it or feel it in this moment? Second question: whatever peace is to you, can you see it or feel it in this moment? If so, where? Please pray with me. Spirit of love, we hear the earth crying out. We hear weeping in the cities. We hear weeping across the nation and across the globe. Thank you for ears that can hear. Thank you for skin that can feel the wind in the light of day. Thank you for the power of imagination and of technology so that we can be connected to what matters most to us, even while we are apart. Our hearts go out to all those who are first responders, healthcare workers, nurses, medical workers, grocery store clerks, people who stock our shelves, all essential employees who are out supporting all of us every single day. We pray they know they are cared for, that they are truly, truly loved, and that they feel the gratitude of this nation. Please beckon us to express that gratitude in person to these people as much as possible, to all those who are literally saving our lives at this moment. All this we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we keep in our hearts until we meet again.
I look forward to talking with you during the talk back following the postlude. As you depart, please remember the one great fact. You are loved and never truly alone.
I dreamed I met a Galilean. Most amazing man. He had that look you very rarely find, the haunting, hunted kind. I asked him to say what had happened, how it all began. I asked again, he never said a word, as if he hadn't heard. And next, the room was full of wild and angry men who seemed to hate this man. They fell on him and then they disappeared again. Then I saw thousands of millions crying for this man. And then I heard them mentioning my name and leaving me the blame.